Hello and welcome to the podcast, STEM Professional Chat by iSTEM Care. And the purpose of this podcast is to bring career stories from STEM professionals who undertook the non-traditional STEM career path. We hope that career journey roadmap discussion with these professionals from STEM community will be helpful for students and early career professionals to craft their own career journeys in the future. So for this podcast today, our guest is Dr. Devjit Datta. We welcome Dr. Devjit on behalf of iSTEM Care. So let me quickly introduce him. In his current role as CHC Open Innovation Lead for Sanofi, Dr. Devjit is responsible for supporting global open innovation activities in the international region and plays a key role in driving categories' efforts to develop strategic partnership and foster breakthrough innovations. Before joining Sanofi, Dr. Devjit was senior manager at National University of Singapore in US as industry liaison office managing commercialization of portfolio of early stage life sciences technology. Before NUS, he was associate at an early stage life science venture capital firm, Esco Ventures X, where he was involved in sourcing and building the investment pipeline of potential deals while performing scientific and commercial due diligence. He has also 5 years R&D experience in biomedical field at various academic labs in US, India and Singapore. Dr. Devjit holds bachelor degree in chemistry from St. Xavier's College, a master's degree in chemistry from Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, and PhD in biological chemistry from University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Dr. Devjit is born and brought up in Kolkata, India, and he's an avid football lover and mixed martial art practitioner. So with this, we welcome Dr. Devjit on this discussion. So to start with discussion, Dr. Devjit, I would like to ask the first question, like what prompted you to make this transition from the biology and to a venture capital? So is there any particular path we have followed and how you made a decision to make such career transitions?
Yeah, thanks, Rasika, for the kind introduction. Appreciate that. There were several motivations, actually, you know. The first thing was, you know, I always believed that I was good at bench science, but I was not great at it. I mean, I was good enough to publish papers and move the field forward, but I always believed being a bench scientist would not have brought out the best or optimum version of me. Because I used to get more excited, more interested in the beginning phase of any projects that I used to start. It's basically the learning phase where you are reading and learning about different technologies and innovations, how to differentiate from those, you know, rather than a phase where you have to go deep in one particular sector or subject matter. And I think that kind of, I had that generalist kind of mindset rather than a specialist. And I realized that, you know, probably with that kind of mindset, I would be a better fit outside academia and in industry, and more in industry, more of a commercial role rather than a bench science role in an industry, I guess. And once I had that kind of realization, I started meeting several people who had made transitions, like from a PhD or a postdoc to industry, and found that, you know, those are the people who kind of have similar wavelength or thought process that I have. Especially, I think the first set of people who I spoke to were all management consultants, PhDs who made a transition to management consultant. And I think they were my primary source of motivation when I first went and spoke to them. To see that actually, you know, being a PhD or a postdoc, you can make a transition to a commercial role in industry. That was my primary source. But it all started from the self-realization of what you are good at and what will bring the best out of you.
Perfect. So you say that you, like, you know, while doing your PhD or post PhD, you realize that you are not meant for bench science, but you are meant for something different, or you wanted to explore a different path, and that path was aligned to looking at things from the managerial point of view or from the management point of view. So do you think that for aspiring candidates who would look up to positions where you are currently, would you suggest them going via the PhD route, or would you suggest that maybe also do an MBA or do an MBA instead of a PhD, or do an MBA with a PhD in order to better suit what you're doing right now? Like, what are your thoughts on management degree per se for your career options?
It's a very good question, Deepak. I believe there are very different kind of trainings. As I said, I think PhDs are more subject matter expertise, we are specialists, and MBAs are more of a generalist approach where, you know, a lot is taught in a 12 or maybe sometimes 24 months, although you can see a lot of 12 months degrees now in MBA. So they're like, a lot of things are taught to make them more generalist kind of personal training. So I'm not saying, you know, so both are good at different things. So PhDs, apart from the technical skill, but which are not, unless you are going to a bench scientist, might not be very relevant. But if you are a PhD, you are very good at identifying, say, a core of a problem, and then different ways of how to solve them, which are very much valued in industry, because industry seeks problem solvers. They also seek people who can learn on the job and produce results and innovate. So in that way, PhDs are definitely highly sought after. However, MBAs also bring some of their own things. For example, you know, they're very good at managing teams and resource utilization, cross-functional, like performing in a matrix organization. Those are taught either through courses or through different team-based activities. And that's why I think that, that's why the entry points are different. Like when you apply for an industry role from a PhD or from an MBA perspective, unless it's a consulting role, right? Then maybe you can actually enter for the same spot, but then again, the firms, you don't compete. I mean, there is a competition between PhDs, but they never compete with an MBA for the same associate or analyst spot. But normally that's why, PhDs are taken for problem solving. And then what happens is, if you want to move to a managerial or a more commercial role, you learn on the job or you pick up skills on the job and then transition horizontally. Like instead of making a vertical transition, you can go horizontal transition. And if needed, you can either do, you can always do a MBA if needed. I don't think it's absolutely needed, because on the job learning can happen if your company kind of allows you to. Or you can take, which kind of upskill you or fulfill the gap that you don't have. An entire MBA might not be needed. You can have a certificate course or maybe a diploma sometimes too. It totally depends on you. However, for an MBA, probably they will enter into a commercial role from the start. They won't enter as innovation or in medical affairs kind of roles, where normally a PhD will enter in an industry. Forget about bench scientist at all, right? So it's a totally different journey, and I think it's a lot of they do complement each other. However, I would say I think it might be easier to pick up those skills for a PhD or learn it on the job. For example, how to do cost modeling, how to learning basics of economics or some other things that you lack, rather than for an MBA to pick up what a PhD is expert at. For example, the whole thought process of hypothesis-driven problem solving and innovate, training your mind in a way that you can continuously innovate, because if you don't, you perish. Those are difficult skills to pick up, and you need a longer training that a PhD, I think, undergoes. So I would say, maybe I'm biased, but I think having a PhD has kind of an edge because you can learn those MBA skills. However, at the same time, I won't say you possess all the skills that an MBA has. You definitely have to make an effort to learn them. So it depends on you, what you want to do. Do you want to enter in a commercial role? Then I would suggest go to an MBA. Then you would enter, in marketing or a competitive analysis kind of role. Or if you want to enter in a technical role and then make a transition to business development, then having a PhD, I think, definitely have an edge.
So how do you justify your skill sets, let it be technical or let it be like more of a management kind of a skill set, to the employer who is not from a scientific background? Like, you know, scientifically, like I feel like whenever we talk to science person together, it's very easy to communicate like what you have done, and like, you know, they can understand your vibe. But when there is some non-scientific person who is sitting next to you and you are going for interviewing something like a management role or something, so how do you display your skill sets during your PhD or whatever the postdoc you have done, and how do you justify that?
Yeah, sure. I think I already mentioned, Rasika, you know, I mean, you have to basically, you know, demonstrate the very fact that you're a problem solver.
Right.
Like the as I mentioned, like the whole idea of learning and innovating is a big plus. And I also mentioned, especially for management consulting kind of roles, where they seek for people who can who already have the training for hypothesis-driven problem solving. Like, you have a hypothesis, you work on it. If it doesn't work, you have another hypothesis, then you test it. That's what we do in our PhDs or postdocs, right? I mean, we have a hypothesis, we design experiments to get results. If the results don't work, we kind of tinker with the hypothesis and then do another set of experiments. And that's very much sought after. I would say, apart from that, communication skills, I can say we develop some communication skills as PhDs, and it's very important to you should be able to communicate that to your to the different people you're talking. Although it's a different kind of communication, it's mostly technical communication, and you mostly communicate to other technical people rather than non-technical people. So, but then at least it's some kind of communication. You present in front of large audience, and those are again important transferable skill sets. So yeah, I think number one, problem solving; number two, innovation, hypothesis-driven problem solving, communication skills. These are all 3 to 4 highly transferable skills that you can highlight. If you are involved in, you know, multi-country projects, it's definitely something that you should highlight. And it will be valued by a non-technical person who you are talking to, especially in an MNC where it's a highly matrixed organization. It's highly valued that you're able to communicate with people from different backgrounds and different culture and different geography. And we normally do that during our projects if you are involved in those kind of projects. I think those are the things that we should definitely kind of try to highlight when we speak to these non-technical people rather. And not much about how many papers we publish or what kind of assays we developed. Those are important, but might not be that important to a non-technical person in the industry.
I was about to come to that question, that because we are from like all PhDs in background, is publishing a paper can make any asset like while displaying your thing or productivity or something like. Do you have any particular experience, like, you know, okay, you have published something, or like whether it has given any advantage? Because many people, because that's again, as we said, like in PhD, our aim is to publish, or more of academia mindset, right? But when we have to go to a managerial mindset, it may or may not contribute. So do you by any chance take any leverage while transitioning, whether it has given any leverage to say that, okay, I have published and it has displayed something?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely important, because as I said, there has to be some measure of your productivity. You cannot just say that I've spent 5 years doing research. That's not exactly a measure. The publications are our measure. Fortunately, unfortunately, I mean, sometimes you might be working very hard but not, you know, publish a lot. But for people who publish, it's definitely an edge, because you're judged sometimes by your numbers. Because for non-technical people, they won't understand what exactly you have done. But then if you tell them I've published, you know, in peer-reviewed journals of like 8 or 10 papers, that shows them that you whatever time you have spent, it has resulted in something.
Right.
So definitely there is an, yeah, you can definitely use it. But what you can, I can give an example, but the difference is in your CV, you can mention I have 8 publications. Mm-hmm. You will not list each of those publications because it would be of no use unless you're applying for a R&D role. If you're applying for a non-R&D role, you never list all your publications. You just mention I have 8 or 10 whatever publications, because that kind of shows that you have produced in all your years of research, and that's it.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm really happy that you said that you don't need to really, because you know many times people have that in mind that, oh, I have only 2 publications and whether I would be able to transition or not, or people are going to judge me. And that's a very good, I can say, input that you have said, that publication, if it is there, yes, good. If it is not there, you don't have to be so much of panicking about it. But yeah, that's good to know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, unless it's an R&D role, I don't think it matters.
Right.
Yeah, I can actually add a point here, because this is something that aspiring, like, you know, either the people who are pursuing their PhD or people who have just finished the PhD and they're not sure of what to do next are very confused about. So one thing that I have noticed is that people, the industry per se does not very much look at the volume, like, you know, 5 paper versus 20 paper is not a comparative value that they look at. What they look at is how did you go through that particular process. So sometimes what happens is that if you made a publication and that publication is actually a part of a project for which you had written the grant and that grant got approved, in your CV, it is always better to write about the grant rather than impacting more on the publication. So you can start putting in the point that so-and-so grant was written and so-and-so amount was released, through which we did so-and-so work, and finally a publication was made. Even if it is a very high impact publication, it does not really matter. More importantly, it was important that you could bring a huge amount of money to your lab. So that shows that you are, you know, multifaceted and you can think beyond just doing lab work.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you have that, if you can give that example, that will be very, very good. That you are self-driven and you can. That's an example of, I would say, entrepreneurial mindset, that you can write a grant and secure that grant, which is again highly valued in industry. So whatever you have achieved, it, as I said, so 5 or 6 years is a long journey. Sometimes we don't realize how much we have achieved. It's not just publications. Publication is one factor, but yeah, grant is one factor. If you have led a cross, you know, border team, also that can be highlighted. It's all about how you highlight it in your CV. But again, the highlight should not be listing all the publications or giving a detailed list of what grant. Like, the number of amount is important. Whatever smaller the amount is, doesn't matter, but it shows that you have taken the ownership of securing that, being, you have tried to be independent, which is value. And yeah, you definitely should highlight, try to be as quantitative as possible.
Okay, so I had one important thing to ask from you. So many of our listeners are either pursuing the PhD or aspiring PhD candidates, or people who have just finished their PhDs, as I just mentioned, and they keep coming across, you know, very catchy profiles, for example, like you, and they just see like the final thing that you've done or the final position that you're at. So they look at that and they're like, oh my God, this, like, you know, this guy is my goal, or this position is my goal and all of that. But what they fail to understand is what all challenges someone had to undergo to reach that particular position. So if you can take some time to, I know that you have, because anyone who has had a change of direction in his career definitely undergoes a lot of troubles, either in his career point or personal problems or whatever may it be. So in your case, I see that you have had quite a few challenges yourself as well. So if you can take some time and explain, like, what all you had to undergo to be where you are right now.
Yeah, absolutely. If there are no challenges, they're probably the wrong path you have taken or chosen. I think I mean, you're very, very much very right, Deepak. So I used to do the same, right? I used to go through LinkedIn and see people have PhDs and then they are these, you know, innovation directors what the role I'm currently in. It's like, how exactly have they made this transition and why I can't do the same thing? How am I lacking any of these things that these guys have? Very valid question, valid points. I think the biggest challenge I had was once I made up the mind, how to, and then, you know, the whole process of job hunting, you know, and there can be through recruiters or it can be like an independent recruiting firms who always come out with these job posts or say the HR in companies. So, but then convincing recruiters that you have the necessary skill set is, I think, was very challenging for me. And then I learned it's the wrong path. You should not try even convincing recruiters, because they won't be able to understand your skill set, because obviously they don't come from the same background. So it's better to reach out to people who are in decision-making positions. I'm not saying HRs are not, they are, but at a later stage. If you can reach out to the hiring manager or someone in similar positions, and that should be your goal. And it's not as easy as it sounds, you know. You have to learn how to reach out to them properly, and there's a lot of hit and miss. But this is basically the way you have to do it. And then, as you mentioned, there are a lot of things that you have to train yourself in, right? I would again like to emphasize that as PhDs or postdocs, we get very much dragged into the depthness of the subject for obvious reasons. We have to. But if you want to transition to an industry commercial role, you should start develop multiple interests outside lab. That's the first step. That's what I did. Get involved with, you know, clubs, societies that interests you, because it kind of opens up that another aspect of your personality. Because PhDs or postdocs tend to be a little more introvert. I'm not saying all of them are. But you have to basically open that another dimension of yours, and that happens when you start picking up other interests, right? A very important also aspect is find a mentor in industry. I didn't have, but I would highly recommend find a right mentor who can guide you. Join groups like, you know, what you guys have, iSTEM Cares. And there are several groups now, actually. I mean, I'm so glad to see most universities or otherwise, they are now coming up with these groups you know, industry people who can actually guide you, starting from, you know, how to write an industry CV, cover letter, how to frame an informational interview, kind of, you know, email or message. So start preparing yourself from that. Speak to as many people as possible from different job functions, because you need to find that sweet spot where you want to be. I mean, for me, it started from management consulting. Of course, I'm not a management consultant today, but I trained for a management consulting job for a long, long time. And I think, although I didn't end up in being one, but I think I benefited a lot from all those preparations, you know, spending hours on how to solve cases actually make me realize how business people think in terms of breaking down a problem and coming up with solutions, and the whole, you, and also develop that comfort level interacting with people. Because what I did was I reached out to partners or directors and directly, and to my surprise, many of them responded. And then if you meet them over coffee or tea and you can have a conversation with them, it not only, I mean, of course, it can result in an interview. That's, of course, a good, practical, tangible thing. But then you also feel a lot good about yourself, that you can carry a conversation with them. You don't feel stupid, and you're not, you know, that you just sit there and listen to them all the time. And doing that, you have to do all these things. You have to read about industry, you know, what's the landscape. If you're interested in a particular company, then what's the history, product portfolio, pipeline. Maybe take some of those classes in Coursera. Because you want to talk about, use the same jargon that industry people use. So all those efforts are necessary. But I would say the first step should be developing multiple interests outside your lab, because you have to be a generalist. You cannot be just a subject matter expertise if you want to transition to a commercial role in industry.
Of what we are discussing, you said like finding a mentor in industry is one of the major kind of step to move in this direction, and also looking at many online resources what you have. So do you suggest, how do you break the ice when you start interacting with such people? Do you find something like a common things to talk about? Because industry people, they have a completely different role as that of what you are right now doing. So how do you break the ice? How do you start the conversation? Are there any online resources also? Have you used any courses you have done, or something, certificate courses you would, something where someone absolutely can go ahead?
In my time, unfortunately, there were not many groups that I see today, the STEM peers, grad grade, all this group, you just have to send a request to join them on LinkedIn.
Right.
Once you join the group, you will find several of these mentors, you just have to reach out to them properly, not send 100 emails on their inbox. Put a proper message. I think they're more than happy to help you, including myself. But what I used to do was, I used to find people on LinkedIn who has made these transitions, or even if they haven't, in a Boston consulting group, there's a consultant who has done his PhD from Columbia University, where I was in New York doing my postdoc. So I'll find some common ground, both are from Columbia, and then send an email message to him or her that, I'm also from Columbia. I see that you have graduated from there. I would like to know what path you have taken. I'm interested in the same, what you're doing now. I'm very eager to know. And they do reply. I mean, they at least can have a phone call with them most of the time. So you can start from there. I used to do that a lot. But now, as I said, there are many of these support groups that you can just know about them and send requests. I also did an entrepreneurship crash course when I was doing my third postdoc in Singapore. It was called Stanford By Design Program. That kind of gave me a crash course on entrepreneurship, which helped me in getting my first role in the venture capital firm in Singapore. So that's what I did. Now I think for any person who would like to go on to a similar journey, it's a little easier now. I'm glad it's like that. There are a lot of these groups, there are YouTube videos where you can just listen to similar podcasts or interviews, where you will find a lot of similar stories like myself, and just learn from them. I would say start getting into one of those groups, like STEM peers or grad grade on LinkedIn can be a good first step for you.
I would like to go a step back to your previous answer when you mentioned about what all people should do. And you specifically, I want to re-ask this thing that you said you have to be a generalist and not really a subject matter expert. Unfortunately, in PhDs, 5 or 6 years training, you are taught to be a subject matter expert. So people are generalists before they start their PhD, and through the training period, they're actually forced to be a subject matter expert. I know that it is very difficult for, although PhDs undergo major grinding as compared to any other degree program, but then after you finish a PhD, because you're so focused on a particular thing, it becomes very difficult to come out of that shell. And a lot of the students who finish their PhDs find it very difficult to transition to different career options. So most of the people, even though they may or may not like the PhD topic very well, they continue doing the same research for the next 20 years, 30 years, or their lifetime, simply because they don't want to go somewhere else. They don't really want to learn about something else. So for them, if there are some pointers on how can you start getting into this generalist mode, maybe expand a bit more on what you say when you say that you have to be a generalist. Just give a bit more examples.
I'll give my example, right? I mean, if you see my research career, I have a PhD in biological chemistry. I worked on tissue engineering, basically modifying cell surfaces with different chemistry and using bioconjugate chemistry to form bottom-up different three-dimensional tissue structures and then study different cell biology on that. But then I moved on to my first postdoc. I did something different, still used chemistry, but more on modifying T cells. So a little bit more on the medical side, the therapeutic side, on how to modify T cells and use them for T cell therapy. And then I moved back to India. I was working on something totally different. I was working more on modifying graphene for antibacterial, making graphene an antibacterial kind of material. And then I moved to Singapore for my final postdoc. It was using my PhD to develop high-throughput 3D platform for screening cancer drugs. So I won't suggest to do these many postdocs. If you can get a chance to make a jump, do that. But I also, when I knew that I want to go to an industry position, I chose my postdocs in a way that I can get at least exposed to different kind of things, not just keep specializing on tissue engineering or one field. So you can do that. And if you are doing multiple postdocs, maybe you can try picking something or do something different that you have not done, that you have already done in your earlier in your career. That can be one way of expanding. And as I said earlier also, try developing interest and get involved with different clubs or societies. I used to, when I was in Colombia, I used to join these clubs where we used to, study about different pharmaceutical companies and their stocks, how the stocks are performing and with time, and how their product portfolio and pipeline dictates those ups and downs of stocks. And these are the companies, it can be, of different therapeutic areas. It can be an oncology company. It can be a company which have different assets like oncology, neurobiology, CNS, hepatic, so then you learn about those things and you automatically pick up, broaden your knowledge base. So although you're continuing your deep research in lab, outside the lab, you start picking up and expanding your, become a generalist slowly. So it doesn't have to be always in the lab. You can also do that if you do multiple stints and by picking those areas. However, you can also become a generalist by picking up interests outside the lab. But then for that, you have to commit hours because, and for that also, I always made sure I don't, unless it doesn't have to be, I never used to spend more than what was needed in lab. And I put hours in doing all these things where I could, pick other things up to kind of make me a generalist. But at the same time, Deepak, I would kind of like to stress, I'm not saying there are no rules where there's a demand for subject matter expertise. For example, it's very hot topic nowadays, and there's a lot of opportunities in medical affairs, in medical science liaison roles, right? And those are more normally people they will seek from your subject matter or therapeutic area of expertise. If you are working on an oncology project, if you have done some clinical experience working with clinical samples in oncology, then they will value that and would probably hire you for a medical science liaison MSL position in oncology. Similarly for other therapeutics area. So there is definitely routes to make transition even if you have subject matter expertise. And then once you are in MSL, with time you can move on to more commercial roles. Those opportunities are always there, but then not many. If you like to be, for example, in my kind of role, if you want to go to a VC, you evaluate technologies every day, hundreds of technologies, hundreds of companies. And it's one day it can be like, an oncology company. Next moment you're evaluating a company who has products on women's health, preeclampsia that you have never heard about. What is preeclampsia? I mentioned that because that was the first project I had when I joined my VC firm. I had zero idea about what preeclampsia is. And I had to attend an international meeting within a week of my joining the firm and talk to different stakeholders and appear to be subject matter expertise on preeclampsia. So unless you pick up stuff fast enough so that you can have a proper conversation with medical doctors within a week's time, It's difficult, and then those are the skills you have to pick up, and you have to start from your PhDs or postdoc times. Once you start reading about different things, start reading about different technologies and therapeutic areas that you are not exposed to in your research.
I think it definitely answers the question, because a lot of people just hear these terminologies that, you know, oh, think beyond the box, think outside your lab area and all of that, but they don't know what to think beyond. So definitely you've given some very good pointers to candidates who are aspiring to be in positions similar to what you are right now. So they also have a direction now. So just one tiny thing, because again, I want this to be very basic for our listeners. Can you just take a minute to say what you mean when you say VCs?
Okay, so VCs means venture capital firms. So basically, what venture capitals do, they fund startups. All these startups that come out, normally these are either technologies from an academic lab that can be commercialized, but then when you need to commercialize something, you need funding. You need funding to start a company, and venture capital firms fund those companies to develop their assets. By assets, I mean their drugs. A startup, for example, is working on a novel gene therapy, for rare disease and blindness, rare eye disease, right? And then they have, for example, say some initial results which are promising, for example, in some in vivo results. But then what? How to develop that into a proper drug in humans, right? You cannot just take it to a big pharma and tell them, can you take this? Because sometimes they won't normally invest in that early of a technology. So what you do is start your own company, but where you get the funding from? Because you cannot apply for an academic grant. Now there are some academic grants, but normally the money comes from private sector. These venture capital firms, they invest in these early stage technologies and take them to a stage, depending on what kind of firm it is, where it's more validated. For example, it can be validated in large animals, or it can be validated maybe some initial human data also, where you can then either take your company to IPO, which is like make the company public, or some big pharma company will come and buy your company or acquire your company. That's when you get profitable. So venture capital firms evaluate a lot of these early stage technologies in academia, and then see which of them are or could be commercialized. So having a good science is not always, it's important, it's very, very important, but not the ultimate thing. They look at a lot of things. How is the intellectual property? Can it be patented? What is the competitive landscape? Is anyone already working on similar area? Maybe they have developed it a lot more, so there's no point of doing another thing. So a lot of these have to be evaluated, and normally there are positions called analysts or associates who do that. Like, that was my first job. So this is what venture capitals do. They fund startups and bring it to a stage where bigger companies can come and acquire them.
Yeah. Right. And I'm happy to know that such venture capital exists in India as well as in many different countries, right? Like all around the world. You have worked for one, which is here.
Yeah, I mean, there are many, many now in US. Boston is full of them. They also have fellowships now, where as a PhD or a postdoc, I think you can get in for a time. I think it's a 6-month, 12-month fellowship, and learn, take up a project, and if you're good at it, they will give you full-time roles. I mean, that's a model that is getting very popular. There are companies like Flagship, Flagship in Boston, another company called it's called Third Rock Venture Capital Firm. So these are all companies that hire a lot of PhDs and postdocs. And also there are fellowships available where you can try your luck and see if it's actually meant for you for 6 to 12 months if there's an opportunity. It's difficult for a non-US citizen, I think, but still an option.
But I think such opportunities are available in India as well as many Asian countries also, right?
Yeah, I mean, Singapore, there are a couple, one or two firms now. Unfortunately, I don't, I mean, China, there are a lot of opportunities if you are willing to go make the jump. But then again, I think it's a little difficult because of the language barrier. In India, I think there are some companies, I think in C-Camp, there are opportunities in the NCBS campus. They have a very good team where we can get involved with them. And there are also many research groups now in India included, where they are getting very much focused on startups. Like the lab that I was in, Praveen Pemula's lab at Instem, this is very, very translational focus. Most of his projects have some kind of commercial value or use. So you can get a lot of these buyback grants that you can use to start your company from the lab and get involved in all those projects. Yeah.
Right. So Pune also has one of the BIREC funded venture capital, which I know. I mean, in India also there are a lot of things which are emerging. I'm really happy to know that there are such transitions can happen, like, you know, not only in India but like even in different countries, and what you have proven the point. Yeah, that's very amazing to know though.
Yeah, not as many as in US. It's still the benchmark. Not even in Europe, to be precise. So US still leads in terms of opportunities, especially if you're in Boston area. There are many firms.
Are right now welcoming like these interdisciplinary things. If you have interdisciplinary skill sets, they are more than happy to take you. I think that's the takeaway.
Yeah, definitely. Yes.
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 Right. I think, globally, we are all progressing, whether it is happening in US or whether it is happening in Europe or India or anywhere of the part. I think sooner or later, people are going beyond the boundaries of their degree programs and making drastic transitions. And it is scary, but at the same time, it is encouraging others to not just be restricted to, like, you know, one point of learning. So gone are the days wherein, like, you know, you had something in the school life and then college life, and then that's it, that's the end of your life. Nowadays it is like, you know, every 3 years you can do something different, and your brain keeps going very sharp, and it does not really stop even at the age of 60 or 70, because I've seen people making drastic changes in their lifestyle and what they're doing even at the age beyond 60. So it's very encouraging for youngsters to think beyond the box and do things like these. Having said that, do you have any final advice for our listeners? It was a wonderful discussion with you. We learned so much from your journey, and I am pretty sure that our listeners would have grasped a lot from you. So do you have any final advice? And one major thing is, you, if you are available on any social platforms, and if you are fine with aspiring candidates reaching out to you, you can just also highlight on that. Feel free and let us know.
So I think the final advice I would only like to stress that, get out of your comfort zone, because end of the day, in academic setting, we are all very protected. It's within our lab, we know our boundaries. It's an academic bubble, so we need to get out of your comfort zone. And as PhDs, we have failures in experiments, and at the same time, teach yourself to listen to no's or rejections, because there'll be quite a few of them, unless you are very, very lucky to make that transition. But I think those are all learning points for you, because slowly, once you start getting, those yeses, it's very rewarding. But then, get out of your comfort zone. You can get in touch with me over LinkedIn. I reply to each and every message in whatever way possible.
So it's been a perfect session. We learned a lot from you, as I said before, and it's inspiring, it's encouraging for us, as well as for people who are pursuing their degree programs, to look far and beyond the box. So yeah, thank you. Thank you once again for joining this session and for just letting us know about your career journey and giving wonderful guidance to our listeners. Thank you.
Yeah, it's been my pleasure. Yeah, thanks Deepak. Thanks Rasika.